Hey all, we are taking a look at the histology of the female reproductive system. We're going to start with the ovary. Here we have an ovary, it's from a cat, but you know, just like a miniature version of the human one. Down here, you can see this is where blood vessels would enter and exit. So this is what's feeding the ovaries. It's a branch of a branch of a branch of the internal iliac artery. But throughout much of the ovary, we see these circular-ish things. Those are called follicles. Follicle just means circle, spherical structure. We see follicles in the thyroid and other places, but these are ovarian follicles. And you can see that they're different sizes, too. That means something. That means that there are different stages of their development. So let's take a closer look. We're at 40x, now we're at 100x. Let's get that in focus. There we go. So here, 100x, we can start to see a little more detail. Of course, it'll be even more in more detail if we go higher. So let's go to a higher magnification. 400x. Okay, you can see a bunch of oocytes. This is an oocyte. That means egg. These oocytes are within really small follicles. The term for that is primordial. These are primordial follicles. So they're really, really early in development. Not all of them will develop at the same time. They go at different paces, and not all of them will fully mature. And not all of them will be ovulated. But these are really, really early oocytes in the center. From here to here, this is the oocyte. Let's find one that's a little farther along. More primordial ones over here. All right, here's a good one. So here we can see from here to here is the oocyte. Oocytes are the largest human cells by volume. Sperm cells are the smallest human cells by volume. There are, of course, longer ones like neurons and muscles, but oocytes in the center, and we have these granulosa cells surrounding. You can see these dark round nuclei. Those are granulosa cells. They're the ones that will be producing estradiol, the major form of estrogen. And then I don't think I see it yet, but what will soon develop are theca cells surrounding outside of that. But this is a primary follicle, so still pretty early on. A secondary follicle, we want to find one that's, well, that one's too big, we'll get to that later. A secondary follicle, I'm finding all the tertiary ones, of course. That's too big. Okay, let's go with this. So here, it's a little bit bigger. We can see the oocyte from here, here to here is the oocytes in the center. We're starting to get some white space in the middle, though. That white space is a fluid surrounding the oocyte, and that fluid space is called an antrum. Watch at the size of the antrum once we go from secondary to tertiary. So we're at a secondary-ish, like primary-secondary follicle. You can see more granulosa cells on the outside, and I can better see theca cells surrounding that. They're flatter than the granulosa cells. Theca cells produce progesterone, and that's important for sustaining a pregnancy. If we go to a tertiary, this is secondary-tertiary follicle on that stage. You can see the oocyte here. Obviously, the follicle is much, much bigger. You can see the oocyte here. These cells surrounding, that's called the corona radiata. And then here's the antrum, much, much bigger antrum. Granulosa cells from here to here, producing estradiol. And then outside of that, you have theca cells, a little bit flatter, surrounding the follicle. Let me go back to 100x to show another example. That one's weird. That's a good one. These two. Back to 400x. Oocyte in the center. Yeah, that's better. Oocyte in the center, corona radiata, antrum is pretty big, granulosa cells, and theca cells. Let's go to this one up here. Oocyte pushed to the side because the antrum has grown so large. Granulosa cells, theca cells surrounding that. Once this antrum swells up so much due to a really high amount of luteinizing hormone that causes the antrum to swell, that means that mature follicle, this tertiary mature follicle, will burst. And that causes the oocyte to be released out of the ovary and hopefully be caught by the fimbriae of the uterine tube and then possibly get fertilized. Those granulosa cells and theca cells are still important. They are very needed if there is a pregnancy to be had. Those granulosa and theca cells, they multiply and produce high amounts of estradiol and progesterone. This is an ovary post-ovulation with what's called a corpus luteum. So you can see the outside of the ovary, but then where's the corpus luteum? It's really big. So see all this, I'm gonna outline it with this arrow. I'm trying to trace this darker part. This is just the outline of the corpus luteum. It sometimes goes in a little bit and then comes back out, goes in, comes back out. This is all, and then that's just one side of it, and then here's the other side. Whoops. All of this is corpus luteum. Corpus luteum produces high levels of estrogen and progesterone because it helps sustain the endometrium of the uterus, helps sustain a pregnancy. If there is no pregnancy, that means there's no human chorionic gonadotropin produced by the fetus. You need HCG to help sustain the corpus luteum. It'll die out, otherwise it'll wither away. It'll be called the corpus albicans, and then the cycle repeats itself. The endometrium gets shed, you menstruate, and you start over. If the egg is, when the egg is ovulated, it's released into the uterine tube, it's released into the uterine tube, otherwise known as the fallopian tube. Here in the fallopian tube, you can see the lumen right here. That's the lumen. We're at 40X, and you can see a lot of smooth muscle surrounding it. Let's go closer. 100X, lots of smooth muscle on the outside and some adventitia, looks like blood vessels and connective tissue. The epithelium, though, is pretty interesting. It's one of the few places in the human body, here's 400X, one of the few places in the human body where we can find cilia. This is ciliated simple columnar epithelium, ciliated simple columnar. It's to help sweep the egg, sweep the oocyte down the uterine tube into the uterus. And the muscle helps as well, helps push the egg or potentially fertilized egg along. Let's see if we can see the cilia. This is 400X. Let's go to 1000. Pretty faint, but it's on the apical side. Can't really get into a good focus. I guess it's best seen here. Here we go. These structures here. Those are the cilia. Past the uterine tube, we make it to the uterus, and the uterus can change depending on the part of the cycle. If a uterus is ready to have an embryo get implanted, the endometrium will be very rich, and this is from a human uterus showing a rich secretory phase endometrium. This here is the lumen, so where the arrow is the lumen. All of this is endometrium. You can see all the epithelium and glands with blood vessels and secreting things to help support a potential pregnancy. So all of that's endometrium. This is what sheds if there is no pregnancy. There'll still be endometrium, it just won't be as thick. And there will be fewer blood vessels. From here, all this lighter stuff, this is smooth muscle, all the way to here, that's the myometrium. The myometrium responds to oxytocin, contracts for labor and delivery. Surrounding the most of the uterus is serosa. It's the peritoneal membrane, visceral peritoneal membrane. Let's take a closer look at the endometrium. This is 100x, 400x. We have simple columnar epithelium. Simple columnar epithelium. Lots of glands deep to the lumen. And blood vessels as well. We go deeper and we get to the muscle, and there's a lot of smooth muscle. That's the uterus. I have another example of uterus. This is from a primate. It's cut a little bit differently. I'm at 40x. Here's the lumen, where the arrow is, and then you can see the glands go deeper, deeper, deeper. All of that's endometrium. From here to here is endometrium. And then we get the myometrium that goes from here all the way pretty much to the edge. And then we have our serosa. One thing you can see, let me go to a higher magnification. This is 100x. Let's go up here. It's 100x, and then 400x. There's that simple columnar. In a uterus that's ready to get an implantation, this is the functional layer where you see all the glands. Let me zoom back out. This is the functional layer where you see all the glands, and then the basal layer is the base. The base doesn't change, the functional layer does. The functional layer is what's shed. It's what's shed during menstruation. Past the uterus, going more out of the body, is the cervix. And the cervix has simple columnar, but then we'll transition at the outer part of the cervix. Cervix just means the neck of the uterus. We transition to stratified squamous, non-keratinized stratified squamous. Ignore the black markings, that's just marker on the slide. But the reason for that is because it's helping narrow down what cells to look at. just like you can swab the inside of your cheek and take off cells to look at those stratified squamous cells that have been sloughed off, here we can look at cervical cells that have been taken off from a swab, from a pap smear, a Papa Nicolaou smear. Pap smears are done to check for irregularities, specifically for cervical cancer. This is 100x. This is 400x. Looks just like a cheek smear, same type of cells, squamous cells. What we're looking for is not the color, but the size of the nucleus. So a nucleus is supposed to be, for these cells, supposed to be pretty small, like this one that I'm pointing at. If you see a large one like this, that's indicative of cervical cancer. So that's why pap smears are so important for detecting these types of cancer and then dealing with it from there. So larger nuclei are irregular. Once we get past the cervix, we get to the vagina, and the vagina is made of stratified squamous, non-keratinized stratified squamous. There is a muscular layer, and that muscular layer is continuous with the myometrium of the uterus. So you can see the stratified squamous here, non-keratinized, muscular layer, and we don't really see past that. That was 40x, now we're at 100x. You can see the stratified squamous pretty clearly. And then these pink, darker pink parts, we're getting to more and more muscle. Where it gets darker is more and more muscle. Stratified squamous, very ordered. Submucosa, and then getting to, there's a blood vessel, and getting to more and more muscle. If there is a pregnancy, then there will be a placenta to help sustain the developing fetus. And the placenta is where you find chorionic villi. Those are blood vessels where maternal blood and fetal blood will exchange nutrients and wastes. So this slide is from placenta. This is at 40x. It's a little hard to see what's going on here. We can see some red stuff, red, the dyed reddish pink, that's the blood. And the white space is where the blood would go, so that's the what we'll call the maternal space. All the circularish stuff, those are the fetal villi. Let's go a little closer. 100x. You can see the maternal space, that's where the maternal blood would flow, and then where fetal blood vessels would be. You can see some examples of fetal blood vessels like this one here. That's where we want exchange of wastes and nutrients. Going a little closer, 400x. There's a fetal blood vessel. And then here's maternal space for maternal blood. Need lots and lots. You see lots of these villi because you need lots of exchange. Increased level, increased surface area. Get lots of oxygen to the fetus and get rid of waste away from the fetus. Finally, if you are pregnant or have given birth, then your mammary glands likely have developed as well to feed the newborn baby. Mammary glands have these roundish sac-like structures, and they're also called alveoli, just like in the lung. And they kind of look similar, but they're not simple squamous. They are called alveoli, but they're not simple squamous. So you see these structures, these are alveoli, and then the really large ones, those are ducts. Let's take a closer, before we take a closer look, we're at 40x right now. These alveoli, they grow in amount and in size if the mammary gland is active. This is an active mammary gland. If those mammary glands are inactive, then they will be smaller and reduced in number. Prolactin will help promote the development, and oxytocin will stimulate the smooth muscle to squeeze the milk out. So you can see the alveoli of the mammary glands better here, and ducts, these larger ducts over here. Let's take a closer look. That was 100x, 400x. Simple cuboidal cells, not simple squamous. Sometimes you'll find stratified squamous. Those are probably going to be for the ducts, but these are simple cuboidal. These release by apocrine secretion, meaning they shed their outer layer, the apical layer. They don't burst like holocrine. They don't release by exocytosis like merocrine. Milk is just shed off pieces of cells. So it contains high amount of fat, proteins, and other nutrients. Here is a duct, and you can see the duct is a bit layered. This looks like stratified cuboidal. Another duct and some alveoli. All right, that's it for the female reproductive system. Please let me know if you have any questions. Thanks for watching.